Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. There's a lot of things to be explained tonight, and we will need all of the time to explain it. Somewhere in the march of life, we've taken the wrong turn, and we've lost part of the definition of ourselves. At the heart of our struggle is to get back what slavery and colonialism took away.
That's right.
And the main thing they took away, not just nation, they took away a nation frame of mind. Most people who migrate through force or circumstances to other countries take with them a nation frame of mind. They have demeaned Africa in the history of the world to such an extent that you're not only not proud as you need to be of an African nation, you have not retained an African frame of mind. And you long to be too many times those things most unlike yourself, and you feed grist into other people's mills. Nothing comes out except what has been put in. Your mind has been programmed into escaping from Africa. Now it has to be reprogrammed to reclaim all Africa and to come into league with all the African people on the face of the earth. We have to stop answering to the word minority, because we were never a minority. A minority. A frightened, insecure minority who may be less than 10% of the world's population, through massive propaganda, have made you assume that you were a minority. With 750 million Africans in Africa, and the count is always poor because it's probably more than that, with 300 million Africans in the Western world, with millions of Africans in India and the South Pacific Islands, we number over a billion people on the face of this earth. If you want to start building back a nation and self-reliance, every person of circumstance, every leader, every teacher, every preacher, every conscious African person must ask and answer the question, how will my people stay on this earth? You have to give priority to the question and the answer. Because once you answer the question, you will start building back what time, circumstances has taken away from you. If you say that my people must be educated, not trained by the oppressor, but educated, because if you are truly educated, you wouldn't be beggars at the door of your oppressor. If you were educated, you would not only get back the nation, you'd get back the nation frame of mind, that portable nation that you can carry with you wherever you are on the face of this earth. You must start with a mirror and like what you see. And once you say, I am an African person, wherever I am on the face of this earth, I am first and foremost in union with other African people. I'm not talking away from the subject of self-reliance and development of the Marcus Garvey movement. I'm talking away from it in order to come to it so you can understand what I'm saying. I know where I am and the significance of where I am. I'm in the state of Virginia, the role model for the American state, the parent of the American state, the frame of mind, the political frame of mind in the Virginia colony shaped the destiny of this country. I'm in the state where slavery began in a formal sense, and where some of the fiercest revolutions against slavery started. I'm here to walk into on the state and on the ground where Nat Turner walked and rebelled. I'm here to communicate with the spirit of Denmark Vesey. And also to call your attention that Virginia was not only a great slave-holding state, it was a slave-breeding state. When everybody who wanted a slave had a slave, and the system became unwieldy, they started breeding them like horses. My great-grandmother spent 3 years roaming around Virginia looking for her lost husband, who had been sold to a slave breeding farm here in Virginia. Now, I maintain that getting on the ships in Africa, when these Africans took a piece of African dirt and put it in their mouth and looked back at their nation for the last time, that was the beginning of an African consciousness that will ultimately lead to Pan-Africanism. On those ships, there were Africans who had never met. There were Igbos, Yorubos, Akan people, different parts of Africa. But finally they realized one thing, in spite of the separation, they were all African. And they were all in the same boat. Now, if you understand what this means for today, you will stop separating yourself based on who's from a Caribbean island, who's from Georgia, and who's from Africa. Today, in the eyes of our enemy, who hopes to continue our oppression to aggrandize his economic status, he makes no distinction between who's in Africa, who's from a Caribbean island, who's from Georgia, AKAs. He'll make no distinction between who's a Delta, who's an AKA. The slave ships brought no Deltas, brought no AKAs. We were all Africans. The slave ship put some down in an island called Jamaica, they became Jamaicans. Another one, an island called Barbados, they became Barbadians. But the slave ships brought no Barbadians, brought no Jamaicans, brought no high yalla, no low yalla. One people. So we went through a process of bastardization when some people are confused about where they belong among us. You can clarify this situation very easily. Your creator, the oppressor, has made no room in his house for you. You either belong among us or you don't belong any place. Now, the whole concept of Africa return, Africa recovered, started on those ships when we understood the oneness of all of us, though we came from different regions in Africa, we had different systems of worship in Africa, we were all one oppressed African people. Once we regained that consciousness, we will stop playing the fool and we will unite. And the mere fact of union of more than a million people, just union itself, even before you fire a gun, organize an army, just the union itself would put you in the arena of world power. Because you began to ask the essential questions about what has been taken away from you and how was your mind programmed into accepting it. They took away not only our history, they mutilated and declared war on our culture. They colonized history and information about history. Then the most disastrous of all colonizations, which plagues us to this day, they colonized the image of God. They dared you to worship a God that looked like you. And you forgot, because you were not that well acquainted with your history, that we were the first people on this earth to create and accept a female God. We were the first people on the earth to accept a female as the head of the army, not the sendow, but the ruler, the leader of an army, and the leader of the state. This question plagues the insecure people of Europe because they grew up in a society where they feared the woman in power. We did not exercise this fear until we came in touch with foreigners, fakers, and fools who did not understand the nature of our culture. We became confused. We became imitators of the culture of our oppressor, and we turned our back on too much that was our culture. We forget something absolutely essential for today, that social agencies were created to take advantage of and to remove the defects in European culture. Why is it that when they came to Africa, not a single person got any information to the contrary, when they came to Africa, they found no insane asylums, because no one had ever gone insane. Found no orphanage, because no one had ever thrown away children. Found no old people's home, because no one had ever discarded grandma and grandpa. They found a basic humanity that we have to get back through understanding. A well-ordered people, a culturally aware people, must take care of the very old, the very young, and the sick and the needy. That was not done in Europe. So this is why they had poor houses. We had never heard of one. This is why they had orphanages, and we had never heard of one. This is why you had to preach humanity while we were living humanity. This is why you need to understand what St. Augustine meant when he started appraising the conference at Nicaea, the conference at Nicaea, 335 AD, He said, these people are giving us a religion we had 3,000 years ago. If we had this religion 3,000 years ago, why didn't our concept last? And their concept lasted. They dogmatized it, formulized it, and propagandized it to the point you think this is the only way to be a Christian, is their way, when you were a better Christian before you knew their way. You did not say, I am my brother's keeper. Because if you have to say, I am my brother's keeper, I'm afraid you're trying to get out of keeping it. But if you're genuine about it, you just go ahead and keep it. They had to proclaim things that they weren't too sure about. We have to dig deeper into our history and dig deeper in some great literature they have created about themselves that repudiates themselves. Why can't we read the work, Roman Africa, and see how the Roman church, corrupt and in disarray, moved over into Europe at the Conference of Nicaea, and it came back to Africa, a crippled child of Africa's original. Why can't we see right now that our enemy has worn out the carbon copy of his original, if indeed he ever had any originality? Now, what has this got to do with the subject? It has everything to do with the subject. Because when people program you into dependency, you make peace with them instead of making peace with yourself, forming an alliance between yourself. If you wear shoes, why not make shoes? If you live in a brick house, why not own a brick yard? Now, what we're trying to get to is that Booker T. Washington taught self-reliance, and self-reliance relates to nationhood. But what we now need to do is to look back at that great 19th century and some of those giants taller than the 20th century giants ever could be. Men more dynamic than Martin Luther King, and I have absolutely nothing against Martin Luther King, but the dynamic ministers of the 19th century, because early in the 19th century, the Africans discovered that the system of chattel slavery was about to be turned into a system of colonialism, a more sophisticated form of slavery. Slavery is never abolished. Slavery is transformed. Only the slave can free the slave. The first thing you have to do is to free the slave's mind from dependency on the oppressor. The Africans then understood that they had lost their land, they lost their place in human history, and the people who got them lost were the last branch of the human race to enter that arena called civilization. They began to have a romance with Rome and Greece. The Europeans don't seem to recognize right now that Europe did not create Rome and Greece. These were two Mediterranean-inspired nations. The challenge of Rome and Greece created Europe. Don't get mad, get smart. Prove me wrong. Do you really? Prove me wrong. There wasn't an organized state in Europe until around 800 BC. And that was two Mediterranean inspired nations, inspired from North Africa, the Mediterranean island, and part of Western Asia. Europe had nothing to do with the creation of Rome and Greece. How is it now that any Scandinavian schoolboy whose nation didn't exist at the time can claim Rome and Greece as part of his heritage? And when you look at Nile Valley civilization that stretches 4,000 miles into the body of Africa, when you look at the Nile as a great culture highway bringing people from the south to the north to farm the south, when we look at the rehearsal for Egyptian civilization, which was in the Sudan, Kush, or Nubia, civilization needs a rehearsal stage. Now, if Europeans say that they built the pyramids, then you would find some experimental pyramids in Europe where they was rehearsing on how to do it. But if you want to look at the rehearsal, go to the Sudan right now. You will see those experimental pyramids. That's where the great show of African civilization was rehearsed and went down the Nile Valley to literally the Broadway of that day and put the show on the road. It was a Southern African show from the beginning. But when people began to take away your nation-ness, they want you to forget that you ever ran a nation and ran it well, exceptionally well. They want you to forget their own historian. They want you to forget Herodotus. And he said the tint of complexion of the Ethiopians and the Egyptians were basically the same. Let us conceive that Herodotus may not have been schooled in African custom or civilization. But let us concede the fact that Herodotus had some good eyesight. This is an observation, not an analysis. So when I look at the Ethiopian, I look at the Egyptian, the color is basically the same. Now, what is that argument about somebody coming from outside of Africa, building one of the greatest enduring civilizations in history, then disappears? Why would anybody be so nice to Africa? At the time the early Egyptian civilization was being built, there were no functioning states in Europe. This was before the first European built a shoe, a house with a window. Why would he leave all that Ice Age, come all the way to Africa, build a great civilization, go back to Europe and live under the Ice Age for 2,000 years before he'd make a shoe? And when they encountered us, we had something they envied and had to destroy in order to be secure. They had to destroy the structure of the state. For 2,000 years, the assault came from Western Asia, now mistakenly called the Middle East. And for another 1,000 years, beginning with the destruction of Carthage during the Punic Wars, it came from Europe. This first massive European attack, Alexander, then the Romans, because the Europeans have a problem with mathematics, especially fractions. The Africans of that day were willing to share the trade of the Mediterranean with Europe, but the Europeans didn't want to share because they don't know how to, 1/4, 1/2, so much for you. They say, oh, I'll take it all. And that's their problem right now at the door of a new form of slavery, and we don't stop it. They want to justify the recolonization of Africa, and they want to take it all. And you've got religions in Africa as the handmaiden of the new slavery, especially Islam. We have to make a separation between Islam and Arabism.
All right.
We must make a separation between conservative Islam and revolutionary Islam. Because in Arab Islam, no woman ever rose to state power. If anybody know me wrong, I'll stop and let them speak. Name her. In revolutionary Islam, Elmina became head of the state of Zara in Nigeria, protected the state, rode at the head of her army, and left her name in history. Also, in revolutionary Islam, Kohana stopped the southward spread of the Arabs and told her son to be Muslim for political reasons, because the European became a Christian for political reasons. And he holds on to it for political reasons. And anytime he can't use it to hold his position in the world, he'll discard it. Because he never believed in it, our democracy. Because it's not democratic. Right now, we are trapped between pan-capitalism and pan-Africanism. And if we go for pan-capitalism, we're volunteering ourselves into the new slavery. If we go for pan-Africanism, we will realize that we have to rebuild the African states. We have to at least acknowledge where the Africans went wrong. They do not manage their wealth producing resources. Until you manage the wealth producing resources, until you control the land, you are not free. You cannot, as in South Africa, foreigners control the gold, the diamonds, the mines, and control 87% of the land. They had 87% of the land when Nelson Mandela came to power. They still have 87% of the land. Now you can move, go through Africa, make all kinds of speeches and associate with all kinds of Africans who are mainly thugs and head of a state who destroyed the Africa that could be. And some of them destroyed it, the Africa that could be, in the name of a religion that the Africans created and do not understand the nature of their creation. That's why we no emphasis now on Bilal, Zayd bin Harit, two great heroes of early Islam. No relationship with the Ethiopian period of Islam, where Ethiopia sheltered the early followers of the Prophet Muhammad until the difficulty blew over and they came back and built a state and ultimately turned on the very Africans who had supported them militarily. In John Jackson's book, Introduction to African Civilization, you should read the chapter called Africa and the Civilizing of Europe. In Eleanor Hoffman's book, Realm of the Evening Star, Morocco and the Land of the Moors, read the chapter called The Rape of Timbuktu. 1591, the North African Arab and Muslim turned on the Africans in the South and destroyed the last of the great independent states in West Africa and permitted the slave trade to spread inland. The Arabs were in the slave trade before Islam, and they're in the slave trade more than ever right now. Now, when some person supposedly representing us dream of a great Islamic superpower, he frightened the hell out of me, because when I study Europe under the domination of the Catholic Church before the Protestant Reformation, this was a form of white enslaving white. And when women spoke up, they began to burn them as witches, sometimes because they failed to be wenches. If a man want to make it with a lady, you know, and she would give him a tumble, I declare you a witch. She wasn't a witch, she just refused to be a wench. Now, if today you think that the black women's liberation movement has to relate to the white women's liberation movement, you are reading history, misreading history. Because once she is free of the domination of the white man, she will join the white man in the oppression of you. You need a liberation movement far stronger and better than anything they've got. And when you restore what you have lost in your journey in the West, you have to ask some questions. If you read Shekinah Diop's The Culture Unity of Black Africa, dealing with the history of the matrilineal, he said he found no evidence for Africans abused women, and the highest tribute was paid to the mother. Even today, many Africans prostrate themselves at the door of their mother and will not rise until she said, "Rise, precious fruit of my womb, and accept my blessings." In an early African courts, if you sentence a man to death, if his mother will not participate in his execution, you can't kill him no matter what he did, because the woman who brought him into the world has the last word as to whether he should be taken out. Now you want to ask some questions of what we lost. You want to ask some questions of here and now. Where did this black woman slapper came from? Where did the abuser came from? You didn't do it in Africa. Why are you doing it here? You're imitating the worst traits of your enemy. You came out of a collective society. And when you were at your best in this collective society, you had the one thing you must regain first and foremost: high morality and collective discipline. You cannot lift a people from a lower to a higher level without morality and discipline. We did not come out of a society where each individual could do his or her thing. Your thing had to relate to the collective thing of the entire people. Now we brought some of this to the New World. We brought some of this to the farms here in Virginia and in Alabama. All sharecroppers in the whole valley, miles and miles, all sharecroppers. When it come to taking that one's corn, all of them got together to get that one's corn in. Take that one's potatoes, all got together to take that one's potatoes. Not a nickel pass. And at the end of the day, the little brown lady who can do miracles in the kitchen put on the good pot, and there was no money exchanged. We gave to each other based on common need, because that's the kind of society we produce. And the Egyptian Pharaoh preached this from a throne 1,300 years before the birth of Christ, and created the concept that Karl Marx would later call communism and socialism. What I'm trying to get to is the propaganda of our oppressor, and using the Bible as propaganda made us think that we were God's stepchildren. And God has no stepchildren, because that is an ungodly act. God has no favored people, no chosen people. God will not choose one people over another, because that would make God a bigot. Right. Nearly all religions do irreligious things in the name of their God. That demeans the concept of their God. Slavery came with the blessing of the church. It was rationalized with the blessings of the church. They had said that God had placed some people outside of humanity. God will not place any people outside of humanity if God is love and God is just, because that would be an ungodly act. Even today, the rationalization for the recolonization of Africa is started by Christians and conservative fundamentalist Arabs. Now, if you had the kind of Muslim superpower that Farrakhan dared to advocate, Adolf Hitler would look like a misbehaving schoolboy in the kind of murdering you'll see. And there's nothing in any religion that places their followers above other people. We must make a distinction between religion and what man imposed on religion, that is his custom. He imposed on people that there are some people in the world not worthy or capable of ruling a state. And we ruled a state before we knew of their existence without these social agencies that he had to have to take up for the defect and his civilization. If no one found any hunger in Africa, whatever condition they were in, they had enough to eat, enough to wear, and a place to stay. At the same time, Europeans were eating out of a garbage can if they could find a garbage can. Now, once your mind fails to grapple with your enemy's condition, it also fails to grapple with your condition. Now you see, in Africa right now, yonder, a state where at least 500,000 Africans were supposed to be killed. But you won't deal with how the Belgians and the French set that up. You won't deal with how the English, the Portuguese, the Spanish, the French engineered walls between one African and another, gave guns to one set of Africans to protect themselves from another, and ended up enslaving both. You won't deal with that, and yet you're quick to say, you Africans sold us into slavery. Let's get one thing clear. Slavery was a three-continent industry requiring a revolution in the building of ships and trade, international commerce. The African did not have that connection. No matter what the African did or did not do, he could not have brought off an enterprise like this. In the system of servitude in Africa, families were not broken up. And after a period of servitude, you could go home. You could also marry into the very family in which you was in servitude. So there is no comparison between what happened to the Africans and the Africans, between themselves. There may not be any justification for it either, but in no way can it be compared to all these 300 years of the draining of people from a continent and the creation of an African frame of mind that made him forget he was once the master of the state. This is why in Africa of today you've got missionary trained, European trained puppets with African bodies and European minds. They have not reclaimed the state and its resources. It's been too many generations since Africans saw Africans ruling a state and ruling it exceptionally well. And for years, this happened. After the fall of Rome, after the rise of Islam, for 1,000 years, Africans ruled independent states in inner West Africa and down the coast of East Africa. Great civilization, one after the other. We have not studied Mashongo, the state that became the Congo. We have not studied the great states of East Africa, partly built by the Africans and the Arabs, nearly always destroyed by the Arabs and their slave trading. We have not studied the destruction of the physical state and the destruction of the state frame of mind. And we have not studied the Bible as one of the great propaganda medias in history. Because people impose things on you in the name of God, because they have taken your image out of the literature of that religion. Look in the Bible as I did earlier, before I was 10, and ask some questions. Why are all the angels white? If God is just, God is kind, he couldn't let one little brown or black angel sneak into heaven. So then what you got to do is what competent scholars have already done. Dr. Ben has already done it. James Jackson have already done it. He read the history of Bible writing and Bible changing. When any dictator in Europe can have the Bible rewritten to suit his will, then you pick up the same Bible and say, it must be true because the Bible says it. It must be true because some dictator changed it to suit his will. Now, I'm not telling you to go away from anything. I think Christianity is a dynamic something that you have misused. I think Islam can be dynamic, but I don't think it is. I think Christianity can be dynamic, but I don't think it is. The Baptist Church takes up more money than 6 small European nations. They don't own a supermarket. Tell them. They don't control any schools. They don't even control the block where the church is located. Because you have not asked the simple question, leader, where are you leading me? And when am I going to get some accountability for the money? I don't think a single thing happened in the march in Washington that couldn't have happened without a march. Now, if some good came out of it organizationally, use that good. If some awareness came out of it, use that awareness. But that's the same thing we should have been doing all along, even without a march. We shouldn't have to be told to adopt our children, because when they're being adopted by whites, they're being programmed into confusion. We shouldn't have to be told that. Nobody needs to march to get that point across. And nobody needs to march to bring up the question of atonement, as though black women came over on separate slave ships, separate auction box. We both suffered together. Either we both got something to atone for, or neither one of us got anything to atone for. And that should have been the ideological basis in the first place. All right, now, I maintain that the great age of state reclamation, recall for the state, was the 19th century, both in Africa, the Caribbean islands, and in the United States. Now let's look at this attempt at state building and how missionary trained Africans ultimately misunderstood Europe's intentions and called on Europe accept some consciousness and lift the burden on Africa, not knowing that where power is concerned then and now, where power is concerned and where they have to maintain it, the European has no consciousness. You like calling on a rabbit to return a piece of lettuce and he's on his way to the brow patch. Well, you can't find it. Now, because the African understood that his religion was being destroyed, his way of life was being destroyed, the consumer cooperative system that he had built in his society was being destroyed, they went to war early in the 19th century. And according to Winston Churchill, they outmaneuvered the best military minds of Europe. Near the end of the 19th century, missionary trained Africans began to call on the European to obey the rules of the Christian church and lessen our oppression. If the European was truly a Christian, he wouldn't be there oppressing in the first place. Revolutions against slavery started in the Caribbean islands before 1619. What is the significance? But before a group of Africans arrived in the United States, the Africans in the Caribbean island already in revolt to take over the state. Why were their revolts more successful than our revolts in the United States? Although numerically we revolted more, they revolted less, but were successful. They could maintain an African culture continuity. They could maintain an African language. They could maintain the African drum. Well, in the United States, these things were outlawed. In the United States, they bought like a brokerage house. They would buy 10 slaves early in the week, might sell 5 before the end of the week. Mama goes one way, Papa goes another way, cousin goes another way. So you're among strangers, and you're not in America 2 months. You're among strangers. And this not only breaks your culture continuity, it breaks your loyalty system. Both of us were victims of circumstances we could not control. So in the 19th century in Africa, they began to call for the return of the state. They were doing special pleading, give us the kind of education that will equip us to rule the state. And no oppressor is going to give you the kind of education that gives you the ability to take his power over you away from him. It's a contradiction in turn. Education for us in this nation is a contradiction in turn, because if we were really educated, we would move toward taking over the nation, and it would be the better for such a move. What went wrong in the Caribbean, what went wrong in Brazil, where you had revolts that brought entire states into being, the state of Palmeiras, the state of Bahia, in Guyana, a whole state came into being, they were fighting the Dutch then, and all before the American Revolution, all before the American Republic, African republics established in Brazil, at the end of South America, culminating in the Haitian revolt that brought Haiti into being. And America declared war against Haiti that's still going on. They did not want an ex-slave state to be sovereign on this hemisphere. The same as they do not want a socialist state or a communist state to be sovereign and peaceful on this hemisphere. They don't want the example to exist. This is why the FBI had to infiltrate the civil rights movement, buy up civil rights workers by the dozens, turn them on their very people, turn them into spies and murderers, because they could not afford to let African people in this country consolidate under one leader or one ideology and stop going into all directions. Ideologically, psychologically, we are worse off right now than we were 10 years after emancipation, and emancipation was a fake. We were clearer during that period about what we wanted, what we needed, how we had to stay together than we are right now. Right now, so many of us in retreat. We don't know who we are in the world, don't know who we are in this nation. America didn't bring you here to give you democracy. Didn't bring you here to be a citizen. And yet you say, I ain't had nothing to do with Africa. I'm in America, I'm in America. Yeah, try to get a cab late at night with your black face. I've arrived at Kennedy late at night, and I've been given from $500 to $2,000 a day for teaching white people how to teach. Some ignorant cab driver not going to take me home. I got enough money with a little maneuver to buy the cab and hire him a chauffeur. I still can't get the cab. Can't get the cab. Yet a white whore can get the cab. A white gangster can get the cab. Now, if that didn't teach us a lesson, what will? A bigoted cab driver is a better pan-Africanist than we are. He looks at all of us as one. So then be one. He don't divide you as to who's a Muslim, who's a Christian, who's a Holy Roller, who's a Delta. None of it. You got the stamp of Africa on your face, and he's afraid to take you home in his cab. Now, John Johnson, who at the time was worth $300 million cash reserve, that means he's paid taxes on it and stashed it away, giving the government his share. He got that much left. John Johnson is about the same complexion as I am, and he's taller. He would have a less chance getting a cab than me, because the cab driver would be more afraid of him than me, because I ain't got my fighting weight or my fighting age. So if the cab driver got any kind of strength, he could have a little success with me. But big John Johnson, 6 feet, he ain't taking no chances. What I'm trying to say is that with the concept of class and status, it hasn't changed. You have to understand, you can change your position without changing your condition. We're just as far away from power right now as we were 10 years after emancipation, because we have lost the concept of the yearning for power. We've lost the knowledge of the power moves made in the 19th century. We have not understood Denmark Vesey well. We have not understood that Denmark Vesey was a Pan-African, and so was Nat Turner. We read David Walker's appeal again. Is there a better Pan-African message than in David Walker's appeal? Stop being passive. Take up arms. He didn't anticipate the ultimate rival of Martin Luther King. He just developed a methodology that suited the critical situation of his time. He knew no freedom was going to be given to us, so he called on us to take up arms. We have not read David Walker well. We've not studied Nat Turner well, or Denmark Vesey, one of the most intelligent of the massive slave rebels. Spoke several languages. Took advantage of his semi-free status and learned languages and traveled. So when we came to the end of that 19th century, we had not lost
I was yearning to be a state again, to be nation again. There emerged a great preacher, heads and shoulders above in Martin Luther King, Bishop Henry McNeil Turner. In the Georgia legislation, he was so angry, he was an elected official. He stood in the legislative council. When time came for him to speak, he would speak 15 minutes on the American flag and how the flag betrayed us. Then he would end by saying, "That flag ain't nothing but a goddamn rag." You don't have black ministers with that kind of nerve today. You don't have a Henry Highland Garnett who said, "My motto is resistance, resistance." A Henry Highland Garnett who would go to Jamaica to rest up among the Jamaican free men from the wars and the torture and the fighting in the United States. And when he discovered that conditions in the United States had not changed, he thanked his Jamaican host and said, "I'm returning to America, not to be integrated because I don't want it, not to seek justice because I don't expect it. I am turning to America to devote the rest of my life in trying to tear that republic down." Black ministers don't speak that way anymore. We haven't matched those dynamics of the 19th century. We haven't matched the spin-off of the long slave revolts in the Caribbean islands that started in the 1527 and thereabouts. Revolt after revolt, ultimately culminating in the independence of Haiti, establishing several republics. But once we look at this, all of this was a move toward nationhood. And at the end of that 19th century, with the American connection, the Caribbean connection, the African connection, there emerged a great scholar, Edmund Wiltmont Blyley. I wish someone would read him today, especially Muslims and Christians. He wrote a classic work, still a classic, Christianity, Islam, and the Negro Race. Still worth reading. His book on African customs and his war against the Africans who wore trousers instead of the African clothes. In a debate in London with Sir Harry Johnson, he said Islam has done more to accommodate African customs than Christianity. So he would prefer Islam over Christianity for that reason. But he qualified himself, he said, if the Africans understood their own indigenous religions, they wouldn't need any, neither Christianity or Islam. Day, in his inaugural address, Liberia College, 1881, he said, "We will have to work for many years to come, not only without support that we need, but without understanding from our own people." He said that we strive to be those things most unlike ourselves, and we feed grist into other people's meals, and nothing comes out except what has been put in, and that then is our great sorrow. This was 1881. He was not only ahead of that time, he's ahead of this time, because he understood that if we are going to reclaim the state, there are certain basic customs we would have to reclaim. Such basic organizational cohesion that we would have to reclaim. I said recently, in looking at organizations that come and go, maybe we need to revise the old African blood brotherhood. We need never to publish a list of its members or its officers, and anybody in it gets so ego-starved they got to talk about it to the non-African people, he'd be expelled immediately. And this needs not only the brotherhood, but a sisterhood, because there are points when only a man can socialize a man and only a woman can socialize a woman. Because there's certain things in the temperament of a woman that another woman understands. There's certain things in the temperament of a man that another man understood. This is no permanent separation, because once this is dealt with separately, then it can come together and be dealt with collectively. We don't have to publicize things. We don't have to have a big ego at the top washing his ego at our expense and taking up collection. I think we should have this as a semi-secret organization, a totally secret organization. We should never publish its list of members, its officers, and the number of people. There could be a billion people in there, but we ain't gonna tell you nothing. Maybe, so we got more than 10, I suspect. Leave you guessing. But we have reached a point where so many black people are anxious for white acceptance that in a critical situation, if you tell a secret to three, you have to distrust two of them. We brought to the world secret organization for good, for trade. The early Masons were not organization or large members. They were actual Masons. And what they kept among themselves is the secrets of building, so they could pass this on down to their own children. This was the first father and son union connection, started among the great craftsmen of Africa. Now the present day Masons have supported the Scotch industry and travel industry. And what else of worth they've done kind of eludes me. But when Prince Hall brought it into being, he did not call it the Black Masons. He called it the African Lodge. We have to look back at that 19th century bid for nationhood to understand the origin of Pan-Africanism, understand the emergence of Bishop Turner and his group. And all of this was 100 years before Marcus Garvey was born. What made Marcus Garvey's movement so attractive in the United States? He came after World War I, when the Secretary of War had told black Americans that your lot in this nation will not be appreciably changed because you participated in this war. We don't even recognize you as part of our nation. We don't even recognize your human beingness. In riots in East St. Louis, they were burning black children alive on bonfires. This would continue until 1919, riots all over the country. Marcus Garvey, a disciple of Booker T. Washington, tried to come to the United States in 1915. He came the year later, Booker T. Washington was dead. He made a tour of the United States, and during that 1919, the Red Summer riots all over the nation, he went to Chicago, he went to different places, and told blacks to rally and fight back. And it's understood, they don't want you here. Not only let's go back to Africa, but let's go back in our own ships. Now we began to dream the great dream that culminated in the UNI convention in Old Madison Square Garden in 1920. By 1923, because of backbiting and betrayal from within, he was in difficulty over the money he had solicited for the ships. He was an honest man and did not steal a single thing. He lived moderately. He dressed up elaborately for parades, but otherwise he walked the street just a common man. What then sent him to jail? The early FBI spy, led by a young man, Edgar Hoover, who's going to lay the head of the Bureau later on, They did not want a charismatic leader to emerge in this country. They had used Booker T. Washington, and Booker T. Washington had used them. They did not even want a person as mild and as calm as Booker T. Washington to emerge. Because after Booker T. Washington's famous Atlanta speech, 1895, most of the Jim Crow laws came into being. 1906, the riot in Brownsville. Du Bois took a bad stand. Washington took a bad stand. They asked for clemency. When you ask for clemency, that implies that someone is guilty. Booker T. Washington died in 1915. By 1916 and 17, Marcus Garvey had entered the center stage of leadership. He taught us to dream again. He taught us to hope again. And if you understand messiahs and messengers, what Booker T. Washington was saying related to what Du Bois was saying. It was not a question of Du Bois or Booker T. Washington. It was Du Bois and Booker T. Washington. They were both right. Du Bois was right with his political approach. Booker T. Washington was right in his approach for self-reliance. Instead of thinking there was a wall between the two, we should have put both of those things together and made a larger movement. The trouble that Marcus Garvey had, the trial, and subsequently is being sent to jail in Atlanta, the gradual decline of his movement that did not see any rebirth until the Italian-Ethiopian War, 1935, 1936, the same year Kwame Nkrumah would come to the United States for education. You see, Kwame Nkrumah picking up the Garvey ideas, the Booker T. Washington ideas, and the Du Bois ideas, and trying to combine them into something called Pan-Africanism. In the Caribbean islands, a Pan-African League did exist. This was converted into a Pan-African Congress that met in London in 1901. Du Bois attended. But after this Congress, the Caribbeans were unable, because of their constitutional fight, to carry on that the Congress struggle. It was carried on from Du Bois picked it up after the first and took it to the fourth. After the fourth, after the ending of World War II, the Caribbeans, the Africans, were mainly the participants in bringing about the fifth Pan-African Congress in Manchester, England, 1945. Out of this Congress came the idea for the solidification of efforts that would bring African states into independence, led by Ghana. After Ghana became independent in 1957, African nations were coming into independence day after day, week after week. The people who controlled the mineral wealth of Africa had educated these new African leaders. And these new African leaders following no great African tradition, but following a concept dreamed up in Europe, did not serve their people as well as they needed to. And Nkrumah did the best and left the most that we can use in the years to come. George Padmore, the prime Pan-Africanist of that day, was Nkrumah's advisor. Most of the ideas attributed to Nkrumah were the ideas of George Padmore. Three Trinidadians helped to bring the concept of Pan-Africanism into being: H. Sylvester Williams, George Padmore, C.L.R. James. While Marcus Garvey was the ultimate Pan-Africanist, is because he asked for the return of the land. He asked for the return of the state. He asked for the return of our history so we can use history as a guide to the building of a state. Recently, just this night, I was asked, what is all of this history, ancient and modern, gonna do for the black child of today? I maintain that all history is a current event. Everything that ever happens continue to happen and will until you correct it. That we are still suffering from the mismanagement of the Roman Empire. It was the Roman Empire and that mismanagement of Christianity that they didn't understand then or now that opened the door for Islam. The Africans thought by adopting Islam, he could get the Romans off of their backs. They were right. They did get the Romans off of their backs. But the Arabs replaced the Romans on their back, and he's still on their back. Now, you can be as Muslim as you want to be. That's your right. But don't be a fool. Many times, white wannabes are worse than whites. More confused than white. And we have not dealt with that phenomenon of using history as an instrument of liberation. If the black child of today understood what we have done in history, what we are doing right now, he'd have a good idea where we have to go and what we must be. A people who love themselves do not kill themselves. A youth who loves themselves and have a definition of his role in history will not feed poison in their veins. And we would need to go back to the concept of community. We need to examine the concept of the nation state. Basil Davidson has written a good book on it called Africa, the Curse of the Nation State. Why is the nation state in Africa a curse? Because the nation state in Africa is un-African. The African built a territorial state, several states existing within the border of one state, several cultures, several religions, no conflict over religions and cultures. But one fertilizing the other, one challenging the other, and challenging without animosity. We were at our best in the multicultural state. Then why are we now rejecting the concept of multicultural that is a sham? Because it has nothing to do with the preservation of African history. It will water down African history because African history can get lost in this watering down. You need concentrated studies in African history. The same people who are now writing books called Not Out of Africa, trying to take away all of the grandeur of Africa. The same people who are now writing the books and advocating multiculturalism were the same people who got killed in the millions in Europe while other Europeans turned their back on them. It had nothing to do with the Africans or the Asians. They did not have a power to stop it anyway. And yet, teaching about the Holocaust is mandated in some schools. Teaching about African history is not mandated in any school. People rise and fall on the basis of institutions. What I am tired of and what I risk my very physical being by exposing, I'm tired of shams and pimps and good speech makers with no substance preying on us, taking up collections and not accounting for it, going on trips around the world with Class A aeroplane, 6 crew, entourage of 30, that costs a fortune. You can save one of the predominantly black colleges with that kind of money. That would have been a more heroic thing to do for us. Keep that doors open. Because there might come a day when either you've got to be educated there or there is no education for you. You got to preserve them, bring them up to standards, keep them at standards, ride hood on that teachers. Get rid of these cop-outs who pimped on anti-poverty program, civil rights movement. You open the door for these black conservatives, except for these kids going to jail, getting their head beaten, wearing jeans all the year round, and living on $10 a week, except for those kids sacrificing, except for Fannie Lou Hamer, except for women like Ella Baker, September Clarke. Those phonies now in big positions at university wouldn't be there. Clarence Thomas, a terrible mistake. He not only wouldn't be on the Supreme Court, he wouldn't be living in the suburbs of Virginia with a white wife. Except for you went to battle for some people and suffered for them, and now they're spitting on you. And we have to stop playing games and call their names. Then we have to ask the question, leader, where are you leading me? And we have to stop following people because they are in power. A story is told about a group of blacks who saw some white people getting on the train. And they got on the train because white people were on the train. Further down, somebody who wasn't so bright asked the question, where is the train going? The engineer, who was the devil, looked back and said that the train is taking you home. So you beware who you follow. You be wise enough to ask some serious questions. Leader, where are you leading me? And if you are not leading me toward the restoration of nation, you're not leading me to any place I want to go. Preacher, what are you preaching to me? If you're preaching to me to be a responsible capitalist, you have to remember it was the capitalist system that got its jump started, its seed money by our enslavement. So it is foolish to expect that same system to save you. I maintain that there is no way for us except a form of Pan-Africanism, the restoration of the best rules of African traditional society, the best values, and a form of socialism based on the best traditions of that society, a caring society, where the king was the guardian of the wealth, but not the owner of any of it. I mean, we did not have to go to Europe to find a concept of African socialism. We have to make a distinction between cooperative pan-capitalism and pan-Africanism that could unite the African world. Somewhere, I have said this repeatedly through the year, in the march of life, in the search for destiny, in the search for the restoration of what slavery and colonialism took away, somewhere on that road, we reached a fork in the road and made the wrong turn. We might have to go back in order to go forward. Let's go back to that figuratively fork in the road and read those signboards again. And when we read a signboard saying nationhood, another one said the restoration of womanhood and manhood and our place in history, collectively saying Pan-African restoration, all of our efforts in every organization we belong to must be an instrument of our liberation, or we must stop letting them misuse our energy. We must not only go back to some of the systems we created, edit them, bring them up to date, we must go back to the spirituality that we create. When we see this indication of Pan-African unity across all religions and sororities and fraternities and social organizations, we are still an African people wherever we are on the face of this earth. And when we see that indication back at the crossroads where we made the wrong turn, when we see the indications toward the total union of African people, not to invade anyone, but to prevent themselves from ever again being invaded, not to oppress anyone, but to prevent themselves from ever again being oppressed. The talent of any African person on the face of the earth belongs to all of the African world. So what then is your far frontier? What then is your mission? Your mission is to unite with African people and reclaim every piece of soil that Africans belong to, especially 12 million square miles called Africa. We might have to tell other people who live there, you will live on our terms, or we will show you the way to the transportation that leads out of here. Then if, in the event, you love Africa so much, you insist on ruling, we will give you a piece of Africa that you can keep indefinitely. The length of your body from head to toe, 6 feet under the ground. We must not hesitate in claiming everything that belongs to us. We're in a fortunate position. We don't have to invade anyone's country, rape anyone's woman, deny anyone of their religion. If we manage Africa, the islands in the Caribbean Sea and islands in the Pacific, and connect with the Africans in India, sometimes called untouchables, sometimes called Dravidians, if we make all of that connection, we are a major force on the face of the earth. That we start producing goods and services for all the African people in the world. Maybe 2/3 of African people can be employed just furnishing goods and service for ourselves. Then if we ever have a leader bold enough to stand before his people, as I have advocated for Martin Luther King, stand before his people, take off all his clothes except his underwear, and say, I will never wear any clothes my people don't make. I will never eat out of a can again. I'll eat natural foods grown on farms, on black farms. I wear a suit that my people make. And that lesson of self-reliance would have brought him to an understanding of Mahatma Gandhi that he did not understand, because Mahatma Gandhi didn't love us anyway. He was an East Indian nationalist. I've got nothing against that. But if we think he was for us, then we have misread history. He was for India, and for India, and for India. He didn't even have a good word to say for China next door. Now, to conclude, we have to rethink and step back and take a good look at the figurative signboards of history. And once we see an arrow pointed in a direction with the word on it, Pan-Africanism or perish, Pan-Africanism, there's nothing else for you. Consolidate or perish. Once we understand that signboard on that road to destiny, we will understand the road that will lead us home. Thank you. Thank you very much. I will, if it is the will of the conveners, I will answer some questions if you have some.
Yes, sir. We're going to be entertaining questions. We're going to have a few questions for Dr. Clarke. And at this time, we would like for those persons here to patronize our vendors. Our vendors have come out and they've been bold enough to be here in this type of environment. And pay their vending fees. So we want to show them that we appreciate them. We want you to go around to the vendors and participate in the exchange of merchandise and cash so that we can make sure that they have fruitful time here as well as you have been here as a participant of the lecture. When we leave here following the questions and answers, we're going to our post reception, which will be held at the Coconut Grove Caribbean Restaurant. It's on Princess Anne Road. The address is 5018 East Princess Anne Road. You leave Norfolk State, go to Princess Anne Road, make a right, go across Stewart's Point, go across the Zay Garden, and you'll come up to, you'll see a, of course, it's a nice cigarette ad somewhere close to the African community that says Mystery. Immediately across the street is the Coconut Grove. You'll see, if anybody's come to the area, you'll notice the Revco there. It's right before the Revco. And we want you to go out to the Coconut Grove, and we will be signing books. We'll be entertaining some more small questions, and we want you to come out and also patronize the Coconut Grove. I know somebody's hungry, right? Somebody here got to be hungry. If you need something to drink, we got ginger beer, juice and sodas in the back, some fruit cups, we got some ginseng, we got some royal jelly, we need some energy, we got some more books over here for some knowledge. We got some quilts to keep you warm because it got a little cold tonight. And we got some more books and things. So patronize these businesses, get some of the herbs, I know everybody needs some. At this point, we want to bring up real quickly before we go to the questions and answers, because we have something that one of the local organizations would like to give you, Dr. Clarke. This is NCOBRA, the National Coalition of Blacks for Reparations in America. Anybody who needs information, now we all need information about ECOBRA or about reparations. You can speak to Brother David or call over to UBNL US with Brother Khalifa and y'all get that information. But Brother David, would you like to come up to the stage, please? If you have questions, please come up to the front left turn so you can ask questions. We have a microphone right here down in the front.
Hey. I'm John Lando, Joseph, Bani Ghani, Jambo, Madassi. We of the NCOBRA Local Organizing Committee, we came back from the Million Man March with the spirit of self-reliance and do for self in the black community. We came back and say that we can produce the things that our community and our people need. As our elder Dr. Clarke reiterated, we should not wear things that we do not make. And so for all of you that are here, we are here to show you and present to our elder, Dr. John Henry Clarke, a product that we produce so you don't have to wear Nike no more. You don't have to wear Reebok. You don't have to wear all the other shoes that you pay a lot of money for that you don't have. So we produce a sneaker. It's called United. It is produced by the Encoma Local Organizing Committee. And we run these out. We gotta get the, our elder size. But this is our shoe. And you can wear this shoe with pride. You know, this is a shoe produced by your own, for your own. It's the do-for-self concept of Marcus Garvey. The do-for-self concept of the most honorable Elijah Muhammad. This is what we got to get back to. Right? And so these are gifts that we present with our elders. You can get more information at the table in the back. And we also produce our own Million Man March calling card. They're already available for you. Our calling card, you can get a calling card. And you know, once you start a card on, you got to, after a certain while, you got to keep it in process. But this is something that money is coming back into our pockets. These are the things that we have to do. It don't make no sense that we come out and get good knowledge and good information and do not put it into practice. You know what I'm saying? That we have not did anything to change our condition. You see what I'm saying? When you change your mind, then you want to change your condition, right? So that's what we want to do. And also, we present to our elders a book that we publish. We are the third largest black publisher of black books in America and the world. UB and U.S. Communication System, and we produce the book, The Original Confession of Nat Turner. Not from a white standpoint, but from the standpoint of his forefathers and his family that's still in Southampton County. So this is the original confession from the word of Nat himself. And also, we had this hat to present also to our elders. It's got George E. M. James on it, the stolen legacy. And we know that Greek philosophy is nothing but stolen Egyptian philosophy or African philosophy. So these are the gifts that we present to our elders. And we also had, you know, information on the cobra and everything. So these are the gifts that we got to do. This is what we have to do when our elder come out. We present the gift to him because we know that when he comes in our midst, it's only by the spirit of the ancestors that he shares that with us, and he's showing our concern and our love for him. We present him with gifts. Definitely, they present Jesus with gifts. We present our own with gifts. We must make the African tradition that we do that. So, hotel, about equality, black law for all black people.
Thank you, Brother David. At this point, we would like to entertain questions. If you have questions for Dr. Clarke, we'll go to this podium here to sit. Okay.
Greetings to you, Dr. Clarke. I find it a special privilege and an honor to be here in your company, sir.
Yeah.
And I've asked your permission, sir, to just ask this question.
Please.
My name is Rashid Tahir. I work over in the community of Portsmouth. I've attempted to do some things that, without asking these Europeans to do things for us, we're attempting to create some jobs and some opportunities by using the brother said something about that word mentor. All of a sudden, I don't want to use that word mentor anymore. But people who are interested in nation building. But I have a question. Among our people now, I have found that a lot of us have acquired a skill. And the skill is writing grants. All right, and I have a real serious problem with grant writers by our people. Because to me, it seems as though, for instance, I saw a grant writer write a grant for a program, and the grant was worth $11,000. And I looked, and the grant writer in his courtroom hall got $8,000 of the $11,000. And $3,000 of it actually got to the program. And actually, about $200 of that actually got to the actual children that the program was supposed to affect. And I have found this to be something that it's like it's gone really out of proportion in our communities, where our so-called leaders today have become grant writers. They are not true people who are there to actually effect a change among our people, but they are pimping the programs and writing grants for themselves. How do we curb this among our people who are leading our children? That's a question. I don't know the answer to it, but I'd just like to know, how do we stop that among our so-called leaders, sir?
In the first place, we're not dealing with leaders, we're dealing with self-appointed parasites using the people. And besides, before he writes a grant and says what he's going to do with it, if it relates to us, we should preside over the expenditure of the grant. A lot of people are writing grants mainly for themselves and their own well-being. People should not be able to write grants in our behalf until it is cleared with us, until we got a clear definition of what's going to happen to the money.
Can we please keep the talking down just a little bit in the back so that the persons who are interested in the question and answer can give the full response to Dr. Clarke?
Okay.
I'm so elated to be here because when I lived in New York City, I came to First World seminars all the time. And so I just have this one question to ask you. As a mother of a teenage female, do you have any suggestions how a mother can, in this madness that we live in, can raise up that female short of leaving this country altogether?
It's not easy, but it's possible because others are doing it successfully. But I'm not saying the majority, but I'm saying that with sound bites and televisions and a misinterpretation of the Bible and the decline of conversation between mothers and their daughters and mothers and their sons, and the decline in conversation between the father, who used to be the authority image in the home, I just don't think that a single mother need have that burden all by herself. Some man, she couldn't give birth to that child, get pregnant, give birth to that child all by herself. I think some force in the community must assist her and making someone share the responsibilities with her. But I'm saying it in this age of misconception where people are making a public mission out of taking off their clothes in public, it's not going to be easy at all getting on talk shows and talking about their sex life, which is a private and supposed to be a discreet thing between two people. I'm saying it's not going to be easy at all, but it's not going to be impossible either. And I'm saying that you should not have to take this burden all by yourself. The community should assist you in some ways.
That's right.
I'm question right now, but I would appreciate it very much if you sisters and brothers would quiet down. You are in the midst of a deity, and you don't even know it. So quiet down, please. Peace.
Yeah.
Father Clarke, so that I'm not being misled or that I'm not misinterpreted, I did understand a lot of things that you said. There were some things that I didn't quite get clear. Did I understand you to say that there was no need for the Million Man March?
Yeah. Yes, I
and
said.
Did it not?
I did say that.
Yes, sir.
I said that there's nothing that has been achieved. It couldn't have been achieved without a march. The march was a stimulation. The crowd was a stimulation. But any time you march a million men to Washington and take up over $3 million and don't account to the people for it, and speak for over 2 hours with the word Africa never crossing your lips, you're out of order. Just like someone asked you about your parents and you refuse to name your mother. I don't think one significant speech was made at the Million Men March. I think one of the people behind the scene is a proven faker, police informer, Melania Karenga. He no more gave you Kwanzaa than he gave you air. I think a whole lot of people with their egos was at the march. I think it was a mistake to call it Farrakhan's Million Man March, because less than 10% of the people there were Muslims. It was basically Christian. The Baptist Church takes up more money than 6 small European nations. And I'm saying that some responsibility has to be assessed across the board. Dorothy Height alone controls over 1 million of black women. She's got a larger following than Farrakhan. The Baptist Church has a following 20 times that of Farrakhan. So why have you gone through the motion of saying this is something of Farrakhan's creation when he's done nothing before our sins are doing the march, but wash his ego in public at our expense? When he went to Africa, the closest person he met that resembles a radical was Winnie Mandela. All the other people were African cop-outs. In Nigeria, with 2 Muslim thugs fighting among themselves and literally destroying the country because they have no sympathy, no feeling for non-Muslims. I mean, when we go into any religion that gives us a lack of feeling for our own people, we have to ask some serious questions. Why are we there? Belong to anything you want to belong to. But 2 months before the march, I said that the march was not necessary. It was ceremonial waste of time and a Farrakhan con game. Nothing has happened since then that made me want to change my mind.
So then, excuse me, do I understand that you suggest that we abandon the hope and inspiration?
That is not what I'm talking about, because there was hope and inspiration out there all along, and a lot of men who brought you that hope and inspiration. John Jackson, we had spent his entire life making an assessment of the role of religion and the powerful role religion can play in our life. We had to take up a collection to bury him. Leo Hansberry, who taught 37 years at Harvard University trying to get across the African history, ancient and modern, died broke. Chancellor Williams died broke, and some hustler in Washington took up money in behalf of revolutionary elders and his own family, sent him to a charity nursing home, had the power of attorney and spent his money. I'm saying that greater messengers have appeared before you and went to that grave broken, disappointed, and brokenhearted. You haven't paid any attention to it. But any well speech-making faker can come before you and give you a false bill of goods. You don't ask no questions. Take up $3 million, go on a worldwide trip that must have cost another $3 million, and you don't ask, where did the money come from? Who's paying you in? And why isn't it that you can do all that marching on Washington and you won't have a single march against the Arab slave trade, against the Arab embassies?
So then, is that why, is that the reason that there should be, from what I understood, we should separate from the efforts that have been made?
I didn't say that at all. I'm saying that the march was not essential to the effort.
Not in reference to the march, but in reference to Pan-Africanism. I understand what you were saying in reference to Pan-Africanism, but from what I understood, like I said, this is my understanding. I'm not speaking in reference to anyone else. I want to hear others to understand that there should be no unity among the Pan-Africanism and the Nation of Islam.
I'm saying, if you understand the Nation of Islam, and if you understand Islam's position and relationship to the Arabs, nothing is more anti-Pan-Africanism than the Arabs and their concept of Islam. Nothing is more anti-Pan-Africanism than that. They're killing women and children in the Sudan. They've enslaving people in Mauritania. The African Muslim in Nigeria taking their Christian servants on the Hajj to Mecca and selling them as slaves. All of this is documented. There's all kinds of organization, Africa Watch, and there's the anti-slavery movement in this country. There's the anti-slavery movement in Britain. There's I've got documents from the Parliament, the House of Lords. I'm stumbling over documents to prove this. You think I'm saying something against African unity? I have been advocating African unity all of my life. So don't put that on my head that I'm against African
That's
unity.
Right.
When I was, before Farrakhan was born, I was going to jail for fighting for African unity.
Understand that we appreciate all questions. We do and must pay respects to the information that is coming and from the perspective from which it is coming. And we want to move through this as quickly as we possibly can and get on to our next mission tonight. If you have further questions, then please come up and ask your question in an expedient manner so that Dr. Clarke can respond to them. But let's not belabor certain issues that we might not understand. Okay, thank you, Pete. Please, Dr. Clarke.
Go ahead.
I understand, well, I have a problem with some professors here at the university dealing on racism. Yeah, some racist people, and I want to know how do we deal with them as a black person? How do we get them out of our university?
I can see that what you're saying is true. And we got racist black teachers. In some colleges, we got racist East Indian teachers. And we got racist white teachers in black universities. And because some of these universities are supported by the state, they can palm themselves off on these universities. Some of them are not even good teachers because some of the same people would not even be permitted to teach in a white school, who can be unloaded on a black school and preach racism right in front of blacks without being chastised, and with sometimes presidents who don't even have enough nerve to call them in and reprimand them, or call them in and ask some serious questions about them. How do you get rid of it? You unite, both with the students and the parents, and document where they are wrong, document that racism, and present it to the president, then make a public issue out of it. And let the public ask the president, why do you still maintain these people on your staff?
Madase.
Yeah.
Madase Clarke. Thank you very much. I appreciate this, your wisdom and your knowledge. I would like to ask you, what's the best book that you can offer or suggest as far as nation building principles are concerned?
There is no one book. E.C. Udom wrote a book called black nationalism, a search for an identity in America. He did it over 30 years ago. It's still relevant. You need to read some books on how Africa lost her independence in order to chart how Africa must regain her independence. Adu Boyne's little book, Topics in West African History. Joseph Harris's very simplified history of Africa called The Africans and Their History. And a small book I did for Black Classics Press, The Africans in World History. You really need to understand why we have been in order to understand where we are and to estimate where we still have to go. I did a book on my lectures in London with Dr. Ben called New Dimensions in African History. In the back of that book is the longest curricula that's been published so far on African history, plus basic references and lecture notes that I use in teaching African history and African-American history in college. Just look in the back of the book. That alone is worth the price of the book. The book is called New Dimensions in African History, published by Africa World Press. I have three books with, I'm dealing with three black publishers, three white publishers. Don't ask me to make a comparison because my heart has been broken enough already. I just don't think the brothers have gotten on to the serious business of publishing serious black books. And you don't have to spend a lifetime trying to learn this. Just basic integrity would do in your relationship to authors. But we have to stop this concept that there's one book that explains anything. If you read several books, there are certain main books. Joseph Harris is a large book on the global dimensions of the African diaspora. It's probably the best book on the Africans outside of Africa and the East African slave trade that sent a lot of Africans to India, who are now sometimes classified as untouchables. But there are other books on the subject, other writers, and LeGrand Craig has done good work on the Africans in Hawaii. There's books on the Africans in Japan, a book called Prehistoric Japan. But you can't stop at any one book because they didn't want to see you slave to the television and the sound bites. Ain't no one book gonna tell you all about everything. You need to also read some books about how the Bible got written. Dr. Ben has written a short book on the subject, which nobody's read. John Jackson's Christianity Before Christ. I've met 10 people who read it yet. And his pagan origins of the Christ myth. People don't want the truth about religion because when it comes to religion, people cop out and want to declare war on everybody who don't believe what they said. And religion, all religions have been used as instruments of our oppression. And we have not asked the proper question, how and why, and who benefits by it. I'm not telling you to leave anything. I'm telling you, you have to reconceptualize it and make it your own. Make it valuable to your revolutionary change because you're in a position of revolutionary change. Everything that touches your life should be an instrument of your liberation, or it should be discarded from your life.
Give thanks and honor to his blessed Baba. Give thanks to be in the presence of his highest deity. And give thanks for all his wisdom, knowledge, and over sending that he was laid upon us tonight. Give thanks for the struggle of our elders and our ancestors. Give thanks for his almighty blessing, Baba.
Thank you.
what we like to do is we like for all of us to stand. Please.
Stand.
Dr. Clarke, we in New Hampshire, Rhode Island, State of Virginia, appreciate your coming to us in the essence in which you've come. And we appreciate the work that you've been doing over the past 40 to 50 years that has liberated many minds of African people the world over. I would like for us as a community here in Hampton Roads to take heed what has been said, and not play, joke, mess around with the information. Time for us to continue to be fools and act like silly children is over. There's too much work to be done. And scholars like Dr. Clarke have been telling us for years, over and over, and the message has not changed, that we must liberate ourselves. No one else should do it, or will do. So Dr. Clarke, we appreciate you. And from the Hampton Roads community, we would like to show you our appreciation and applause and sending you off back to New York tomorrow morning. But we do want you to come out to the reception tonight at Coconut Grove.